Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS current affair analysis for 9th July 2020, and these are the couple of articles we'll be dealing today. The first article for the day is taken from the Live Mint and it is titled India's Ayush Industry Needs an Entirely New Regulatory Model. So the context of this news is a recent controversy surrounding the drug announced by Patanjali, which is headed or promoted by famous yoga guru Baba Ramdev. So Patanjali announced that it came up with a drug named Coronil, and according to the claims of Patanjali, the drug has ability to cure COVID-19, but there was a controversy regarding the efficacy of this drug because it did not undergo actual regulatory processes, and it is way too early to say that it can cure COVID-19, which has been a major cause of concern for scientists across the world. So without a lack of proper formidable research and empirical evidence, it has raised some serious questions on the regulatory model of Ayush. Now, if you want to know what Ayush means, generally there are two streams of medicines broadly. One is the conventional allopathy or the English medicine, which we understand in our proper healthcare. So our proper healthcare systems are driven by this allopathy. Apart from this, we also have certain indigenous or traditional medicine, which is also called alternative medicine, and all this alternative medicine requires a proper research. Now, there was a ministry which was formed after NDA came into power in 2014. So this ministry which was created is an umbrella ministry which caters to the research and all the regulatory environment required for Ayurveda, Yoga, Naturopathy, Unani, Siddha and Homeopathy. Now, right after the pandemic, we have seen certain Ayush products or what is believed to be this alternative medicine. We are not sure whether they are certified by Ayush or not also, but they were available in the market. So they were marketed for coronavirus cure or increasing the immunity without any research or any empirical evidence to back up their claims. So we also had various Ayush drugs which were sold in the markets, and they claimed that they would be curing a lot of diseases like diabetes, malaria, dengue, without submitting any sort of proof that our industry needs. So, is there any regulatory framework for this? Yes. Under the Drugs and Cosmetics Act in 1964, the industry can manufacture any product based on substances mentioned in the traditional books listed under this legislation. In 2018, the Ayush Ministry amended India's Drugs and Cosmetic Rules 1945. So, this prohibited manufacturers of Ayush drugs from advertising their products having therapeutic claims. However, the industry has time and again managed to get a stay on this amendment from Delhi High Court in January 2019. So this brings us to the point that we need certain regulatory framework in place to deal with this problem. It is not the alternative system that is the problem, but the fake claims or misinformation that spreads in the name of Ayush, that is a bigger problem. Now, if we take a look at the prohibition, it is limited to just publication only. So, and it does not actually address the direct marketing of these products to Ayush practitioners. So, these doctors who prescribe these medicines, they are not regulated by any kind of a law. And they are free to do it because the law has a loophole in this. The prohibition is only till publication, but they can directly by verbal communication say that a particular product might be good enough for treating a particular disease. But nobody knows the efficacy of that, and that is the biggest problem. Now, if you have to point out at one major difference between the traditional allopathy or English medicine or the traditional medicines that we find in the market, it is relating to the concept of active ingredients. Now, in the Ayush industry, the plant-based resources are directly used, or say for example, a leaf or a herb or a root, it is directly used in the medicine. But unlike in Ayush, the allopathic medicines are created by isolating and stabilizing active ingredients. So, from plants, creating this active ingredients is one of the biggest challenge, and this is also a challenge not just in this industry, in general, in chemistry. By establishing the principles of chemistry, isolating this active ingredients is the real problem. Without a pure form of a drug's active substance, it is not possible to understand the dose at which it will deliver its intended therapeutic benefits. So this issue is also not addressed properly in Ayush. Unlike elsewhere in the world, there is another practice where most of the Indians just pick up drugs over the counter without any doctor's prescription. As we have seen in a lot of cases, say for example TB, it has led to multi-drug resistance. Now, this is one of the side effects of unregulated usage of medicines. If it is the case with already regulated English medicines, what will be the case if active ingredients and other information regarding alternative medicine is not clearly available and people are still using it? What could be the long-term effects? Nobody knows. So there is definitely a need to strengthen the rule. More than anything else, there is definitely a need to explore the potential of alternative medicines, because if we look at our ancient scriptures, there have been certain medications and their efficacy has been proved in certain areas as well. But because of practices that are prevalent in the society right now, which is not backed by a proper scientific research, ultimately, pharma industry is a business. Now, if there is a greater demand for alternative medicine in the market and they're getting away with such loopholes in the existing framework, there is every possibility that the traditional or the conventional allopathy medicine or English medicine might want to take shortcuts. So there is a possibility that the pharmaceutical industry as such would demand relaxed rules, which ultimately will affect the entire public, which will impair the efficacy of normal drugs also. We would be finding it very difficult to separate fake drugs from genuine drugs. That is the last thing we need in our pharmaceutical industry. Hence, what is the way forward? Firstly, there is a need to relook at the laws. We have been talking about the Drugs and Cosmetics Act 1964 and the subsequent rules. So they must be relooked at and rules must be strengthened. Secondly, over-the-counter OTC drugs or over-the-counter drugs should be regulated immediately. Thirdly, there should be certain regulation on advertisements. That is a big menace, because misinformed people might spend a lot of money without any desired results. Next thing is, we have to focus on a wider movement in the Indian society led by doctors and scientists, where we are focusing on scientific temper as envisaged in our fundamental duties as well. So this is very much required in the larger context of healthcare. We have to remember that healthcare is not just a system where you treat a disease. Healthcare actually means well-being. Now, it is this aspect of well-being that traditionally all the indigenous systems have focused upon. Now, it is only a sad reality that alternative medicine's potential is not utilized to the fullest extent possible. So, we have to move towards that direction. Another important need that we have to focus on is India has a shortage of human resources in medical healthcare. So, human resources in medical field can be added if alternative medicine is also taken into confidence by the public. Now that will happen only when there is a culture which promotes scientific research rather than blind belief. That is the gist of this article. The next article for the day is taken from the Indian Express and it is titled, Who is Caring for Children? So this is regarding the vulnerable nature of children. And in the context of the pandemic, 2020 has been a very devastating year for adolescents and kids especially, because we are looking at a generation which would be overwhelmed by stress, anxiety and uncertainty about their future. We have millions of kids who are willing to go to college but they're not able to get access to proper education. There is also this problem of digital divide and also a problem of attention span. So everything that has been considered normal, human touch, say engagement with fellow students, get-togethers, festivals, assemblies, all this were pretty much a part of a adolescent's life. Now that has been taken away. In a situation where adults who have more maturity levels are finding it tough to cope with the situation, what is the situation of most of the adolescents like? So this is the central premise of this article. If you are looking at any particular age group, that should be between the age group of 13 to 17. So this is the age group where there is increased developmental motivation to do something and they have a lot of energy. Teenage also makes it very difficult for coping with anxiety, stress and the uncertainty because of the hormonal changes induced in our body along with the adolescent dynamics, which make them highly sensitive to social status and peer groups. So if they have a feeling that they're not in a position to achieve their dreams, that is going to affect their morale in a very bad way. Now, just to put things into context, we have seen a lot of TikTok stars. So right after TikTok ban, we have seen a lot of adolescents or probably teenagers in the age group of 16 to 19 who committed suicide because they were not able to take the news that TikTok would no longer be a platform for their activities. Another important point that has been emphasized upon is apart from the usual intelligence, we generally know about intelligence quotient, which is a measure of your comprehension ability, emotional quotient, which is a measure of your ability to maintain peace with others and be responsible, honest and respect the boundaries. There is the social quotient, which is a measure of your ability to build a network of friends. All these are taught to a certain extent in our schools, but there is one important aspect that we are missing, that is the adversity quotient. Whenever we're talking about adversity quotient, which is a measure of our ability to go through a rough patch in life and come out without losing your mind. This is very important and this is not taught in a lot of schools. This is because traditionally we have always believed that mental health issues were not really important. Probably that has got a lot to do with the cultural ethos, because traditionally, Indian families had a joint family system, and when you have such a huge family support, it is very often that we find support from one member of the family or the other. And this kind of isolated lives that we are seeing right now in a lot of urban setups is not heard of in hitherto, let's say, pre-LPG era Indian families. So the kids who grew up in such an environment are definitely not the kind of kids that you find in the present generation. So because of this lockdown, initially a lot of students were very happy because they had a extended vacation, but over a period of time suddenly their safety and security has been threatened and challenged from multiple angles. They feel very congested and jailed, and they don't know what to do. So the more common stresses that teens are facing are like say for example someone from your family becoming ill, or non-stop pandemic news which is very gloomy, which paints a very bad picture of the future. The family economics, that is your parents losing your jobs, or say the financial situation not being so good. There is also the loss of traditional milestones in their school activities as well. Like say for example, they miss their school time, their activities, and also their aspirations are taking a hit. Now this adolescence is a stage of major transition. Yes, we can definitely make up to the lost time, but whenever a particular individual is going through a rough patch, it is important for that individual to have a supportive ecosystem. Now, adolescence is one such sensitive stage which requires more amount of attention and care and understanding, because it is this age which shapes up their thought processes for the future. So it is in this context that we have to focus on our mental health as well. This is a golden opportunity for our country to bring awareness about mental health situations. If there is any warning sign of a depression, there is definitely a necessity for parents acknowledging that and addressing the emotional changes or any feelings of despair and emptiness. Now the big question is, how can they cope? So this has been the biggest question. Now to find a simple answer for this, we observe that adolescents always watch out for adults for any sort of psychological cues. If parents are calm, the children in turn will be more confident of their well-being. What may seem trivial to an adult may be very, very important for a teenager. So dismissing all these concerns will definitely have an impact on their mental health as well as psychological well-being. So it is important for the parents to address the situations. Now what can governments do? It is not just the government. Government is already overburdened with a lot of things. The onus is upon the civil society, the schools, and all the psychologists coming together to communicate to the public at large that this times will pass, and teach how kids should try to adapt to this situation and come out strongly. So one of the major challenge has been the online teaching model. Even teachers are finding it very difficult to adjust to this model, and the social emotional learning that generally we associate with schools is missing, because they're not in direct contact with the children. So it is this areas that we have to talk about, start our debates, start our discussions to ultimately understand how we can best serve the society. This should not just be limited to the national level, subnational level. Right from the grassroots level, this is an issue that has been affecting the world over, because this is a pandemic. Now it is important in this context to mainstream this idea that it is okay to be overwhelmed, but also tease the kids that we will eventually get through this crisis. That is the gist of this article. Now where can we actually use this news item? So for example, there is a particular aspect of the syllabus that is GS2 vulnerable sections. So in that, children can be one of the vulnerable sections. And with respect to the rights of children, we have UNCRC or UN Convention on Rights of Children. So it is from that framework you have to extrapolate that aspects of UNCRC and apply those concepts in the present context. So that is the key takeaway. This particular news item can be a very important one in the dimension of adversity quotient, which can be asked in interviews, and also ethics case studies or essays, any way you can use this. But the understanding that this age is where developmental motivation is maximum and how it has affected children in the age of pandemic is very important. So that's the key takeaway, and I hope you understood this. That's it for the day. Thank you.